In this video, we will discuss one purpose, many flavors. So what do I mean with this topic? For example, if you have one purpose, for example being herding, you have a lot of different flavors to get. Of course, when talking about herding type of breeds, one could think about the shepherds, like for example the German shepherd, but also the Belgian shepherd, such as the Malinois and the Dutch shepherds. But those shepherds, being a herding breed by origin, have now mitigated towards protection, tactical breeds. So for police work, especially Dutch shepherd, and more so even the Malinois, and the crosses thereof, sometimes also involving German shepherd, are the pick of choice for police and military applications. So it gives you some insight that some herding breeds could also be used for protection work. And why is that? Because all herding breeds have a channeled prey drive. So instead of hunting the sheep, for example, or other cattle like herding tasks, they will just chase them and therefore be an extension of the shepherd or the herder as a person who wants to herd the sheep or the cattle, for example. So that gives you some insight. There are also more pure herding breeds that are still being worked as a herder of, for example, sheep. Most known examples are the border collie, which has a very intense stare and controls the sheep a lot with his eyes, and also very good stamina. And there's also another breed that is very known, which is the Kelpie. The benefit of those two breeds is that they have extreme stamina, very big hearts. I think the border collie of working strains has an even better heart than that of Australian Kelpie, whereas Australian Kelpie can cope a lot better with extreme heat and lack of fresh water to drink of. So it depends on what you need, and also Kelpies are a little bit more rough there. They don't use that intense stare that the border collie uses that much, but are more of a intimidating type of herding breed. Another example that's now very popular as an upcoming pet or show dog is the Australian Shepherd dog. This is a dog that they use in Australia to herd cattle. And this dog has many of the characteristics of the European breeds. So a little bit like a border collie, but more stocky. And it comes from Basque's origin, so of the region of Spain especially. And also suspect at least infusion of the Australian cattle dog, but I come back to that one later. This Australian Shepherd dog has a lot of the properties of the border collie, but a rougher dog. So what do I mean? They had to handle Australian cattle, and also still are handling cows. And those cows are of course a lot bigger and more aggressive than sheep are, and that demands a stronger type of dog. So not as fast, not as good of endurance as the border collie and the Kelpie has, but a lot more strength to back it up, and also has more applications also as a guard dog, because it's less easily intimidated. Then also the other Australian breed, Australian Shepherd dog. This is a little bit smaller breed than the Australian Shepherd. This Australian cattle dog is a little bit more bulky and has a lot more courage still. It also is renowned for its endurance, for being such a bulky dog and also able to fend for itself. They say in Australia, if it doesn't kill the Australian cattle dog, he will eat it. He also has a little bit of dingo blood in its veins, but quite a little. And they're also called healers, Australian healers, being red when they have a red collar, or blue when they have a blue collar. And this also gives you insight in what type of herding breeds they are. They will just bite at the heels of the cattle, and the cattle is, especially in Australia, enormously feral because they have so much acres of land with so much cattle on it. They have very little human-human interaction, so the cattle with humans, and they have developed as a semi-feral cattle breed, so to say. And that required quite a strong dog, and also very important to tell is that there are have been infusions with Bull and Terrier breeds. That could be the reason that they are a little bit smaller, but will especially be the reason that they are quite strong. So they have a very strong head and also strong shoulders and feet. If you look up Malinois, that's about perhaps even 10 centimeters or higher at the winter, or more at the winter than the Australian Shepherd of the same sex, so male compared with male or female with female. You see a similar sized head and feet on those dogs, so that gives you some insight. The Australian cattle dog is quite compact, but it's enormously strong, and also with that Bull and Terrier influences, they're very sturdy and good workers. They can also be an excellent guard dog. They are not being used as a protection breed because they are quite stubborn and independent thinkers, but they are very nice all-round farm dogs that next to herding even the tough flocks of cattle would be quite quite too rough on the sheep, but could also exterminate if you have some vermin, for example rats there, or feral dogs. They can chase them off, or coyotes for example. And also they have good guarding instincts and are quite courageous. Even if they get hit, they are quite reluctant to release. So good all-round dog if you could get one from working alliance. Nowadays a lot of them are bred for looks and to look extremely bulky, which is a shame. That bull blood infusion brings me also back to the Malinois and the Dutch Shepherd X. They are often crossed among each other, so Dutch Shepherd and Belgian Shepherd. So the Dutch being a brindle, the Belgian being a red, or different shades of that. Sometimes also in the same litter, and oftentimes also a little bit of German Shepherd is added. But very often they also add a little bit of bull blood to make them more stable, more trustworthy, and a lot more able to stick it out with some and go and get stuff. So that could also be an option. If you look at a Malinois or Dutch Shepherd X and it's quite heavy in the bull blood, you could have a different take that a smaller Australian cattle dog also is, but more of a protection-based dog. In my opinion, I would rather get an Australian cattle dog because they are quite friendly, often with children. I would not keep them with very small children unsupervised because of the strong healing instinct. But I think they are a lot more dependable than your average performance bred Malinois, because they are bred very often from lines and generation on generations to combat against humans, and are quite temperamental, and you don't want them to interfere, for example, when the two children have a little brawl. Have a great day. Today we will talk about baying dogs and catch dogs, because there's a misconception that baying dogs only bark. In my opinion, this is not true. They keep at bay, so at from harm's way, if possible, if their opponent is strong. For example, if they face a hawk or a more of a terrier type of situation when they face a badger. But that does not mean that baying type of dogs are not killing or biting dogs. Oftentimes when those dogs that would bay at a hawk, so a swine, or at a badger, face something smaller, for example a deer, or up below ground when they face a fox, or for an easy example is rats. Those baying terriers will make quick work of rats because they can easily kill them. So what a baying terrier in particular does is they will kill what they can quite easily kill. If there's a big chance of becoming hurt themselves, for example when they face off a badger, then they will often bay, or if they face off a big fox, they will also bay. But those same terriers often are not baying when they face, for example, a rat or something smaller. And that's a difference. The same with those baying type of dogs. Oftentimes when they are able to catch a hawk with a group, and the catch dogs already have engaged, so there's not a big chance of becoming harmed, they will just chip in and will grab as well. For example, Catahoula leopard dogs are known to also bite and catch together with other dogs, but they are not the primary catch dog. So what's the difference then with a catch dog? They are both hunting and both biting. A catch dog will engage even if he cannot win. So for example, there are catch dogs that are really going against a hawk. For example, even better, they'll sometimes try to stop the hawk, while that hawk will just throw it around like a ragdoll. Another example is American Pickle Terrier. And of course the bigger catch dogs like American Bulldog, especially Scott type, Dogo Argentino and the likes. Those type of dogs will just engage regardless if they are able to win. And also those type of terriers, when they face off a very big fox or a badger, they will just go at it and engage with that badger, not barking and keeping it busy, but they will keep it busy also very physically. And there are benefits and drawbacks of both, and very often also in a hunting set of dogs, for example with hawk hunting, they have dogs that are of the baying type to alert where the hawk is, but also dogs of the catch dog type. So there's a Border Terrier and a Labrador of the catch dog type to get the hawk and fix it so that the hunter is able to kill it and take it home. And there are, as mentioned, of course, if you have catch dogs, there's a very big benefit. That's the quarry. We have no chance of escaping unless the dog has died or is unable to continue. Whereas with baying dogs, you have very little chance of the dogs to be destroyed, because they keep out of harm's way as much as possible. Whereas they will oftentimes keep the quarry busy, and also the hunters are easier drawn to the location of the quarry. So it's not that baying types of dogs are just all bark, no bites. They just know when to do it and when not. So they have a higher survival instinct. But of course there's a bigger chance that the prey gets away, because if a catch dog has the opportunity to catch, he will attempt to. Another thing is that there are also mixed versions, so dogs that can do both. For example, when their boss tells them to catch, they will catch, and otherwise they will be the baying type. This can also be the asset to a working environment. But very often, they're a jack of all trades, but a master of none. So some examples where catch dog type of dogs are beneficial more than baying type of dogs. Because oftentimes also the other way around, baying type of dogs will take a lot less damage and can be hunted very often, whereas catch dogs, they take a lot of damage. But one example, for example, a terrier of the baying type faces a fox on the ground, and he's baying at the fox, and the fox slowly moves forward or backward, and there's that play between the fox and the terrier. And then the terrier gets hurt by, for example, very big male fox, and perhaps doesn't want to continue anymore. That could be one role, and the fox escapes. Another thing is that when he goes back and forth, the fox in his den, that he has sees another escape route, and of course, because he's baying, the hunters know where to dig, and they dig in there, but through that other escape route, he just escapes and goes into another digging set altogether, so they have to dig, start digging altogether again. Also, some creatures, for example, badgers, are very good at digging new holes to be dug by the hunters. You can imagine what happens. Whereas the catch dog, once he's able to latch on, he will just latch on. And with that catch dog on it, the fox or badger has a far worse chance of getting away, of course. Another example. Of course, when you have hawks and you have no protection, your dogs have a big chance of getting hurt. But one of the benefits of a catch dog is that once the catch dog latches on, the other dogs have it quite a lot easier and can also help out. Another example is when you have dogs that are just baying and you and the hawks try to direct their aggression against the hunters. You as a hunter can get extreme damage. That's also the reason why they developed these catch type of dogs, because in the earlier times, for example the Middle Ages, if you got hurt, seriously hurt, you could die. There was no care system as we know now. If you were not able to provide for yourself, it's game over. Oh, this bad weather. Very bad weather now. But with the catch dog, the dog takes the damage instead of you. And when the dog is taking the damage, you will be quite safe. If that hawk tries to attack you and the dog is able to, you will latch on and stop the hawk. And if the dog, is not stopped because it's such a big hawk, he will have trouble being as fast as he would without the dog latched on. Oh, he doesn't really like this rain crap. Look at him. This is my Pretzel Terrier. Pretzel is also a catch dog type of terrier. So really engaging. Type of dog or a mixed type of dog, the big benefit is that you get a lot less damage on your dog. And for example, if this catch dog type of dog faces a badger, he will be in recuperation for quite a while, whereas a mixed or baying type of dog, perhaps you will miss out on the badger, but he will live and will not be damaged that much. There is a thing that persons like about also wolves do. The wolf is not a baying type of dog. It just howls to express its proximity to the other wolves, but it's not howling, for example, to keep the quarry, the prey, occupied. It would just engage. So a wolf is also more natural and it's more fair fight. For example, if wolf is facing moose or swines. The swines and the moose can also damage the wolves, of course. And it's the same like the catch dog. Also, the catch dog, terrier versus the badger. The badger has a bigger chance to survive than the terrier has on average. Of course, the terrier will be helped by the digging crew, that raises the chances dramatically. But it's not without consequence, and also a lot of terriers, especially the catchdog types, don't live to an old age. But the baby types often can still live to an old age. Bye bye. And also, if you have a group of baying type of dogs, they will sustain no damage. You still know where they are, and you can have your assisted hunting, and they assist your hunting. And the killing is often done with a gun. With catch dogs, the killing can be done by with more older type of weaponry. For example, in the tradition Argentinian hog hunting, the killing has been done by a big knife, and also in Germany and other places, it's still a recommended solution. Why? Because if you have catch dogs, you don't want to risk to hurt your dog. If it's latched on and the hog will just turn it, or the dog will turn and you will shoot the dog, it will have a bad day or die. Whereas if you go in with a big spear or a knife, you can pinpoint much more safe. And why do they need such a big knife? Especially a hawk has thick layers of muscles and also fat protecting the heart. So you need quite some reach to reach in and to destroy. Whereas if you have more of a baying type of dogs, you have to rely far more on the shooting, which can also, especially if you have a big pack of baying dogs, a bullet can ricochet, and also you can hit an area that's not as well protected, For example, the hawk can miss the heart, and then the hawk will go on for quite a while wounded, and then you have to follow the blood trail with your dogs again. So it's not that in modern times the baying dogs are the best way to go, as I mentioned. Of course, for the damage per dog, this is a lot less, but you need also more advanced options to help them out. Whereas with the catch dog type of approach, you need very little material. If you would let the catch dog, you would even try to kill them themselves. So what is the modern role of the catch dog? As I mentioned in one of my other videos, the catch dog is a type of dog that latches on, but that also will allow you to precisely, because for example the hawk is being catched by this catch dog that holds the hawk out on the ear or the nose or somewhere else, and then that allows you to precisely direct the hit, so for example to hit the heart with for example a hawk killing knife that Argentinian but also European and Russian hunters normally use. But there's a drawback in that precise hunting, is that you have a dog that will sustain a lot of damage. By doing so, you will be able to quickly kill the hawk, and also you will prevent damage to other dogs by shooting and ricocheting bullets, and also to other hunters, because also bullets can hit them. And also, of course, yourself, because if the hawk charges for you, it will be a lot harder when there's a catch dog on it. So there are quite some benefits, but the drawback of the damage is still remaining. And how do they deal with that? They use modern day protective vests. So a little bit that can already help is a big collar, as you can see here, which protects part of the arteries in the neck of the dog, which are quite close to the surface, but still it can be hurt on a lot of other places. And also the collar can shift, so they have even wider collars that reduce the movement of the neck, of course, to some degree, but not extremely. And they also have a protective vest. So the protective vest will also protect your chest, the ribs, and especially the middle area of the body from being affected by the vest. For example, a hawk. These protective vests are for above the ground work, whatever you work, of course, you can imagine such a vest. To the branches so much, but by getting stuck in those holes and suffocating, because the airflow will also be further restricted. Dirt will get in and between the body and the vest, and you will all get more and more formidable each second or each minute that you're dragging that vest across those tight dents. So those vests can also only help when you are not underground. And that's a modern way to approach hunting, with all the benefits of the catch-up place, also modern equipment as well. And also in the past they used this, they even had armored dogs also for war. Sometimes they also had pins on their back or something else, so that they would just walk below the horses and cut open them from underneath, and that way they were anti-cavalry. But they also used this leather type of vest for hawk hunting and other hunting activities. But the leather vests are quite heavy. They also will still be able to be penetrated, whereas some modern materials such as Kevlar are both very light and giving more possibility for the dog to exchange heat with the environment, so to cool off, which is a good thing, but also are very hard to penetrate. So that's how it goes in modern times. Have a good Today we will discuss an extinct English Terrier known as the Coverwood Terrier. You've probably seen the pictures that I showed you. And this is a toy type of Bull Terrier. This is different than the miniature Bull Terrier that we know now, because in the past the Bull Terrier came in different size, but weight. But this Coverwood Terrier is different because it is really a toy terrier. They are named after the kennel that produced them, namely Coverwood, and they could be 4 pounds heavy. So 4 pounds heavy is the same as 1.8 kilogram. So that would be the size of a Chihuahua. And then they said it was a miniature Bull Terrier. But also, if you look at those Coverwood Terriers, in my opinion, they far more resemble a Chihuahua than they do an English Bull Terrier. Even the old English Bull Terriers that looked a lot more like a working Bull Terrier. So they have quite a lot of their face covered by eyes. And there was also another terrier that became extinct, the English White Terrier, which also was a show terrier. And both the Bull Terrier, especially the toy versions, and the white versions on average, but the toy versions were almost always white. And the same with the English White Terrier, they were really plagued by deafness as a disease, and deafness is quite a lot associated with white dogs. If you breed them for color instead of performance. And the other thing is that the Coverwood Terriers were that brittle, that they were the most brittle of all type of terriers, so to say. And that's exactly not something a Bull Terrier should be, brittle. So am I sad that the Coverwood Terriers have passed? Not that much. Of course, it would be cool if they had a really scaled down working terrier. That would always be a cool thing. But remember, also the English Bull Terrier, from its origin, was never a working dog. Of course, in that time frame, all dogs worked a little bit, but you could not compare them with the pit dogs, the collared bull and terriers that they brought to the same level in the stakes, and also the stories that they could even beat them would be very hard. There were, of course, bull and terriers mixed with especially the English White Terrier, which was quite brittle, as I mentioned. And also other breeds were involved. The Bull Terrier also carried a little bit of Dalmatian blood. And running dog, in case of Borzoi, was probably also added to make the head shape as we know it now, the egg-shaped head. And of course, some Bull Terriers are able to work, but they are on a different level as compared to the pit dogs, the Bull Terriers. And if you're looking for a small Bull and Terrier, you could look like I mentioned in the beginning, to the miniature Bull Terrier, which is still a dog in the range of 10 to 40 kilogram often. Or you could look at, for example, a Bull Russell, which carries miniature Bull Terrier blood, but also often Jack Russell or Parson Russell blood, which are often a little bit lighter, but still have the Bull Terrier look. So, or if you're really looking at a Bull and Terrier, you could look at a Patterdale, which can be 5 kilograms or less in some strains, but also a lot bigger in others. Have a great day. In today's episode, we are going to talk about quite a lot of topics, namely fatal dog attacks, and also we look at the difference between wild canines and domesticated canines. Is it truly so that the wolves are not stronger in bite force than domesticated dogs? Also, we will talk about some saying that Teddy Roosevelt told that he saw a wolf kill a bull and terrier of fighting pedigree and slay both mastiffs as well in very short order. Is this possible? Or should we look at it a little bit different? And also, are there animals brave enough to challenge animals that are a lot bigger and wilder, etc.? And is it possible that a smaller fighting dog of different pedigree can be victorious over a bigger one? So first, starting with the fatal bite statistics. The first word that should be mentioned is that by fatal, very often time smaller dogs will be excluded, because the chance that a small dog is able to cause fatal injury to a human is of course a lot less than what a bigger dog could do. Second of all, I showed a paragraph. It should be, and I cannot stress this enough, corrected for the amount of dogs of a certain breed. So for example, just giving you an illustration, if you have five deaths caused by foxes in a country and one by a wolf, then you could conclude that those foxes are more fatal to humans than wolves are. Whereas if you would know that there are 200,000 foxes in that area and only one wolf, you can imagine that wolves are a lot more fatal, but there are just a lot less of them. If you do correct for this phenomenon, you will see that, albeit being a lot of pit bulls are present in the United States, the relative occurrence of fatal attacks are very low compared to many other breeds. For example, something that's enormously fluffy like a Shoshone has almost 7,000 higher chance of a fatal incident as compared to that of an American Pit Bull Terrier. Another thing of relevance in this discussion is that American Pit Bull Terriers are often classified in a group called Pit Bull Type of Dogs. This is a large group that includes many type of dogs, and not all should be called American Pit Bull Terriers. A last thing is that American Pit Bull Terriers were originally bred for the pit, so to fight each other, and they were in the pit with two handlers, one handler of their team, an handler of the opponent team, and a referee. And if they would bite one of those, they should be disqualified. That doesn't mean that an American Pit Bull Terrier should not be able to damage a human, because some, even in game lines, did. And that is breeders that just wanted to have a good dog. It was very good in competition, but was not selected to be not human aggressive. So, that being said, the vast majority of pit bull dogs, real pit bull dogs, are extremely human friendly. But it should not be an advice to keep, for example, children unsupervised or not be on your toes, especially if it's a dog that you do not know. One of the tests that many people do is to see if a dog could be dangerous, is to see how they act. If they get something that they really like to eat, will they try to attack you if you mess with their food? They call this food aggression, which you see in many animals being wild or domesticated. I don't like my dog to be food aggressive. He isn't food aggressive. And this other dog that I had, the Irish Staffordshire Bull Terrier, was also not food aggressive against humans. Both against humans. To each other, they could be. They also tried to eat each other's food balls as soon as possible. So that's a difference. Aggression between animals should not be the same as aggression between human and animal. So that being said, next to the topic of wolves, many people claim that wolves are a lot stronger than dogs, and they are in general, because wolves are very big animals and they will also kill on a daily basis just to feed themselves. They're also a lot healthier. They can grow up to very respective ages, especially in captivity, because they don't have to deal with competition and to keep up with the quarry, the prey that they have to kill to stay alive. So they have big benefits. Also, they have very good compromise of a big head, big teeth in a relatively small package. Yeah? But they are very big. There are different types of wolves, and the biggest can reach substantial weight, almost 80 kilograms. The biggest ones that they found. The smaller ones can be in the bracket of 20 kilograms. So there can be a factor of 4 between different types of wolves and different specimens. And also in the dog world, you have very small dogs. For example, this one is quite a small dog, 12 kilogram. But you also have dogs over 100 kilogram. So those could have a factor of 10 applied. Yeah? And there are smaller dogs, there are dogs of 2 kilograms. So then you have a factor of 50 applied between the different breeds. But it should also be known that being a good predator, wolves rely on the pack normally for hunting, especially if they face big opponents or strong opponents. And why? Because if they do so, they can live another day and hunt with the pack the next day again, or the next week when if they are really wounded, but still they can survive. Whereas some dogs are bred to be that courageous that they go regardless of the damages that they are done to them. And an example could be some hunting dogs, or catch dogs, that normally would not be able to dispatch the biggest quarry that they latch onto. But sometimes they are able. For example, American Bulldog, Dogo Argentino, killing a hawk, but also sometimes the hawk kills them. And they will also do it alone. But there are even braver breeds. Breeds that are go underground, like Peterbilt Terriers versus foxes that are the same size or even bigger, but also the badger that can be a lot bigger. And a badger is, for its weight, relative weight, like all marten type of animals, extremely strong. Many people say that the ultimate test you could give a dog is to let it face off with a badger. Not because that's a nice thing to do, of course it isn't, but the badger is a ferocious and very strong adversary, and many a dog would just whimper at the thought of facing them. Whereas some small dogs, including Pattedale Terriers, but also for example Border Terriers when they were youth, and Yap Terriers will still face them. And some as a baying dog, but also some as a catch dog. And you have dogs bred for the pit. As I mentioned with the American Pit Bull Terrier, those dogs were bred to face each other, but also in history, they were bred to face whatever was thrown against them. It started with the bulldogs, and the bull is so much stronger and bigger animal, still the bulldogs would face them. And those dogs were also used against bears, lions, and what have you. So you can imagine the kind of bravery that those type of dogs display. And if you also can imagine that a wolf wants to live another day, if those would face off without the pack, one-on-one, it would be a different situation than when the wolf is in the strength. He decides when to attack on his condition, when he has the pack with him and the surprise element. Whereas they have equal chances, there will be a different outcome with some breeds. And of course, many of the breeds that we all know are just dogs that are bred to be companions and living on the sofa and in a cozy house, whereas the wolves are roaming and killing. And that would not be any chance that they will survive against the wolves. But dogs that are bred for combat, oftentimes illegal combat, in many districts and geographic regions. But those dogs are different because they are also bred to do combat, and they're not so much bred to be a survivalist, but to bred to be a winner. And that's different. So, for example, a 20-kilogram American Pit Bull Terrier will try everything he can against a 40-kilogram or 60-kilogram opponent. And that's also where the Tosa Inu story comes in, because the Tosa Inu is another real fighting breed. It's like the sumo tradition in Japan, where warriors face off and they see which one wins according to their rules. In case of Tosa fighting, those dogs are in a ring together with each other, but without a referee, without handlers inside the ring. These type of dogs are also a lot less human friendly than, for example, American Pit Bull Terriers, because of different rules. And also, those dogs are not allowed to make a sound. For big dogs as they can be, you have Tosas that are very small, ranging to 20 kilograms and up, but also extremely big Tosas. They can reach up to 80 kilograms and still be working as a fighting dog. And those will face off for a long time, sometimes 30 minutes or more, and they are not allowed to make a sound. So you can imagine that instead of trying to flee when they get a lot of damage, they still will be there and even will not whimper. But compared to even that type of dogs which were bred for combat since the 1400s, so more than 600 years already, selected the best to beat the best, and they have a culture in Japan that the bigger is better. Not only big in Japan, but also, for example, in the sumos, you see colossal fighters face off with each other. Same with this Tosa-san, the heavyweight class. And a heavyweight Tosa was pitted against a big American Pit Bull Terrier. That heavyweight Tosa was a 10 times winner, so a double grand champion, as they call. And the Pit Bull was a 6-time winner, a grand champion as well. Not a double grand champion, but a grand champion. And the Tosa and the pit fought 1 hour and 12 minutes, after which the American Pit Bull Terrier was declared the winner and the Tosa died after the fight. So you can imagine that if the Tosa was at least double the size of that American Pit Bull Terrier, would have such big troubles with American Pit Bull Terrier. You can imagine a wolf that was not bred for combat, but bred as a survivalist and a hunter, would not fare better. And that doesn't mean that wolves cannot kill American Pit Bull Terriers, because they can. But oftentimes it is not the real American Pit Bull Terrier, but the show variety. That's one. And also, there's a difference in the pack than one-on-one. And I even must say that American Pit Bull Terrier could be killed by a pack of coyotes, which are a lot smaller, because the pack can work. And if you're ripped out, open everywhere, that could be a big problem. Coyotes also lure in bigger dogs, even Rottweilers. And a Rottweiler could easily kill a coyote. But once the pack falls down on that Rottweiler, there will be a different scenario unfolding. So in the wild, wolves act in a pack and then they kill. And also if your dog is on the chain, they have very little chance of surviving. Very little chance, but it is not the same. Also, there are dogs bred to protect the flock from wolves. And sometimes they have two or three of those dogs with a flock. But of course, the wolf pack is a lot bigger. But if you have two or three Congo dogs with protective collars, which help a lot, that the dogs will not be easily lacerated to the veins in their neck and thereby killed. But also, if a wolf tries to bite it, it will damage itself, and then they have to do it a different way. And still, Kangos can die. But if you have a pack of three Kangos, they very often easily protect your flock against bigger wolf packs of even 10 to 12 pack members by deterring them. The wolves are smart animals and would rather pick a fight that's easier, with less chance of being damaged. But also, if they do, the Kangos often survive and the wolves often die. But it can also be the other way around, especially if the pack is bigger and bigger, the chance of the dogs will become less and less. And also single Kango can easily be destroyed. A last thing, Kango are livestock protection breeds, like for example also the Tibetan Mastiff, which are a lot less confrontational as a combat type of dog. And why? Also, if you for example look at the Tibetan Mastiff, if you would put a snow leopard there, and it's often documented, it can even deter 4 to 5 Tibetan Mastiffs away from the prey, even if the prey is a flock member. Whereas if you had 4 American Pit Bull Terriers there, perhaps they would die. Also like in the pits when they died facing lions, but they will engage. And that's a different scenario altogether. Hey, more. Go spiky. So that brings us to the end. I also included a figure that shows you the relative bite force. So it's interesting to see the bite force, but of course if an animal is a lot bigger, you can imagine that they will bite a lot harder, because it's just a physics game, because there's a lot more room for muscles and you have more leverage. But there's also a thing that is relative bite force. So what this does is, like I said, the relative fatalities, it decreases the bite force to a universal level, so you're able to compare different breeds on the same size. And then you see that wolves do bite quite hard, but for example, a Tasmanian devil for the same size will bite 50% harder. And that's also a thing. If you look at the marten family, you also see very strong biters that are present there. And that, for example, makes the badger such a formidable opponent for a canine. And also why a wolverine is not an easy prey for wolves. But of course, a pack of wolves can dispatch of a wolverine a lot easier. But wolverines are known to fight off bears, grown bears of their prey. And it's not because the bear, if he would really engage, could not kill the wolverine. But it's a hard thing to do and very little to gain, because you get a little bit of additional meat. The wolverine is not such a big of an animal, but the chances of serious damage to yourself are high. And also you will be weakened for other hunts. So that's the reason why they don't like to face off those wild alpha predators with a prey that's able to defend itself very very proficiently. The same you see with honey badgers. Lions have to put a lot of time in to kill a honey badger, also leopards. Not saying that he cannot kill them, but it's very, very hard. And that's also the reason why I think that many people exaggerate the chances of a wolf killing a combat bred canine. And of course, it's not that we as humans can do better than nature, but nature simply hasn't selected on the same criteria. If you look at longevity, vitality, you have to live to a long age. Very often time a wolf will grow a lot older than a dog, and especially if you compare it with dogs the same size, because smaller dogs tend to grow to an older age. Wolves are far better, and also wolves are very good generalists, they are all-rounders, whereas a dog bred for combat doesn't need to be such an all-rounder. For example, the sense of smell for a game dog is a lot less important than it is for a wolf. Okay, a last thing is that game dogs are bred to be that determined and that good athletes that they are very often bred into other animals, including running dogs, greyhounds, whippets, but also hunting dogs, for example Rhodesian Ridgebacks, or Dogo Argentino, or what have you, bull lurchers, but also in protection type of dogs, to make them more reliable and more stress dependent. For example, in Malinois crosses and Dutch Shepherd crosses that are used by the military or the police. And of course, wolves could also give extreme benefits because of their health, etc., and their hybrid figure. But they have a drawback, that they have a temperament that's unreliable with humans. And also, as I mentioned, for many of tasks, you need a dog that is reliable under stress, whereas nature normally says, okay, there's a too big of chance of getting injured, better get away. And that's not something that man likes in its domesticated animals. Have a great day. Oh, the dog here on the leash is my Petterbilt Terrier, 1.5 years old. And it's a earth-going terrier. So one of my subscribers checked in, asked me a question: is there something about the Petterbilt that you want to change? And if so, why? First of all, I want to discriminate between two types of dogs, in my opinion. Dogs that you want to evolve into something else, based on, for example, your own characteristic or your own preference, and dogs that are bred for a specific purpose. And in my opinion, those latter are the Petterbilts. So they are bred for specific purpose, they are specialists, and they are not like the first, for example, a show dog that's evolving because a certain trait gives higher pup prices or a better chance of winning confirmation shows. That being said, of course, also in each breed you have different strains, and those strains, especially in performance breeds where they are line bred, could give you a specific type of character. So if you look at the two extremities, you have very small Petterbilts that are now being used, especially on groundhog and the likes in the United States. So those are sometimes 5 kilograms or below, also good for rabbit hunting. And you have very big type of Petterbilts that are more for badger hunting or raccoon hunting. And the dog that you see here is the latter. It's the bigger variety. And also you have Petterbilts that are very much a catch dog, also like this dog, so a silent type of working terrier that's really engaged. And the other extremity will be more of a baying type of dog, and a baying type of dog you don't often see in a Petterbilt. It's more of a Russell trait, baying type of dog. Petterbilts, some Petterbilts do have mixed characteristics, so they can both be a baying dog but also a catch dog, and you do see this in Petterbilts. And for me, I like the dog to be as much as a catch dog as possible and also as silent as possible. And for my preference, I like a dog that's silent also in house, if not needed, don't make all that noise and fuss. So it gives you a little bit of vision about my position on this matter. That being said, if you want something else, there are other types of dogs you could look into who have a lot of the characteristics that you love in the Petterbilt as well. If you like them a little bit less energetic, you could look at the Border Terriers, also of some other colors. And the Petterbilt comes in black, brown, red, sometimes black and tan. That are normally the colors that you want to look at, whereas for example border terrier comes in a little bit of different colorations, also a little bit of different head. If you wanted to have a show breed, you could look at a Laken terrier, that's closest to the Pattedale terrier in the show breed. I think if you would be looking at the two breeds that closest resemble the working Pattedale terrier, it would be the border terrier and the Laken terrier, both being show recognized breeds. If you want something a different color or a lot more loud, you could look at the Russells. Hi. And even in the Russells, yeah, parts of the Russells can be quite silent as well. Also good little dogs. There's also something a little bit more in between, called the Plummer Terrier. Looking like a Russell, but predominantly red, also carries a little bit of beagle blood and more Pattedale blood lately. Another breed, if you want a pure hunting dog, would be a German Hunting Terrier, Deutsche Jagd Terrier, which is, in my opinion, a very good little dog and more of an all-rounder, but not a good dog to keep in house. I would keep a German Hunter Terrier outside because they are, in my opinion, quite neurotic. If you want a bigger hunting terrier, you could look at the Heide Terrier, for example. And also in the Heide Terrier you have specimens that are quite smooth coated, whereas you also have the Airedale type of coat. But if you really look into them, you can also find them smooth coated, so like a big Pattedale. If you want them for different purposes, you could also look at if you want a little bit more of a relaxed type of dog, you could look into a Staffordshire Bull Terrier. And you also have working strains therein who are less relaxed again, but a lot more driven and healthy and more performing, but they could be less relaxed in the interaction with other dogs, a little bit more dog aggressive, and sometimes also other animals. And if you want a faster dog for hunting, you could look into crosses of Pattedales and Whippets, which could be a good lurcher type of dog and still carry a little bit of the Pattedale character in a faster dog. And I think that sums it up quite nicely. Of course, if you want a bigger dog, performance dog, with similar catstock type of traits, you could also look at American Pitbull Terrier, or even bigger dog, Argentino, of working strains. For example, boar hunting, a lot similar to the Heide Terrier, which is a more of a mixed type of approach oftentimes. So carrying a little bit more of a baying type of blood. But there are quite some options. And to come back to the question, I like the strains of Pattedales that are a little bit more sturdy and bigger. They do have some drawbacks because of the size. They cannot be used in all type of quarry if you want to be hunting them. The benefit of a little bit of bigger dog is that they can handle themselves better against a stronger quarry. You won't be overrun by a badger, and also if another dog attacks them, they have a little bit of more of a chance of surviving than a very small type of dog, of course. I like them to be of the silent type with a sturdy head, sturdy body, so less fragile than those snipey types of heads. Less neurotic than a baying type or mixed type of Pattedales. Hope this helps. Have a great day. So, sometimes I'm asked, I want a Pattedale type of dog, but with an FCE registered pedigree. There could be two types of persons. One type of person that wants to show their dog, and the other type of person that needs to have a FCE registration. Otherwise, it could not be classified a breed and will be in trouble of keeping it. Some legislations tell you that you need an FCE registration to perform or to keep your dog. Now, let's start with the first. If you want to show your breed, why would you get a Labrador type of terrier? If you want to have the looks, but a lot more exaggerated, you could do a bold route. If you want to have the rough coat, you could go the route of the Lakeland Terrier. A, if you want to have the broken coat, you could go the route of, for example, the Border Terrier. And if you want to have the variety but a lot more exaggerated, you could look at the Staffordshire Bull Terrier, which is a lot wider, broader type, more of a bully type of dog, but still carries a smooth coat and a lot of the attributes that you also find in the Patterdale. If you want to just keep a dog that is closest resembling that of a Patterdale but has an FCE registered pedigree, you could look at Lakeland Terriers that are of working strains, but they will very rarely also have a FCE registration, because oftentimes also in working strains other blood is infused now and then to make them perform as good as possible. Or you could look at Border Terriers. And also Border Terriers come sometimes with working registration or working line performance type and FCE registration. I think your chances would be higher than with the Lakeland Terriers, because oftentimes those that work their dogs will keep working Lakelands or Black Lakelands that are oftentimes Patterdale Terriers. So that gives you a little bit of insight of what you could do depending on what your requirements are, and if that also suits your family, of course. Have a great day. My dog is 1.5 year old. Patterdale Terrier, also known as a black fell, smooth coat. As you can see, he's a cross between two lines, Boot Sire and the Claude Bred Dam. He carries also from both sides the Jones blood, also known as pickaxe kennels. Some people of you are runners, so long distance runners or short distance runners, joggers or the likes. And how cool would it be if you could save 70% of time or run 70% faster? Same you, same track. Okay. The only difference would be that you have a dog together with you that accompanies you. And is also your running buddy and pulls you to a certain degree. This is called Canicross. And what you need for it is quite easy. In its essence, you need a dog and yourself, of course. But the best way to approach is that the dog is in a harness, so that not all the stress is put on its neck by pulling you. And also that you yourself are in a harness. And in that harness, you will also put a lot less stress on your arms, because if I would run like this, and I also did this quite some times, and you can also test it out just on the leash, with you holding it, but then your arm movement is a little bit more restricted, whereas if you have a harness that's at your belly or hip level, that helps a lot, also puts the center of gravity a little bit lower, but 70% faster. And there's a YouTube video, I will also make some screenshots of it to show you where you can find it, and that did two times the same track and was able to have over 70% increase in speed, which is tremendous in my opinion. There was already an athlete that was able to have a good running speed and was now a lot better. And it's a fun way also for your dog, of course, to get it in the exercise modus, also for yourself. It's good to build on your stamina and keep your cardiovascular system working. And I just wanted to share it with you. Hope you like it. And look at the pictures to see the complete mission. Have a great day. Bye bye.